Hey guys, I am happy to share with you my latest DIY speaker project. It is the most ambitious wireless speaker I've made so far, and it's packed with cool tricks like support for Wi-Fi and Spotify streaming, as well as digital signal processing or DSP. All of this is housed in a sturdy plywood enclosure covered with natural walnut veneer. Overall, this project has been quite a challenge, but it's also been a great learning experience, so let me show you how it came together. It all started with this amplifier bought by Arylic. You can watch my last video for more details on what it can do, but to summarize, this board has everything you need to make a very capable DIY speaker. In addition to Bluetooth, it has Wi-Fi, so it can stream directly from services like Spotify or Tidal. It has a built-in stereo amplifier that can produce up to 50 watts per channel. And the DSP feature lets you fine-tune the sound to your liking. You can even use the expansion ports to add external buttons and LED lights. I should also disclose that the board was sent to me for free by Arylic to be featured on the channel. To get better sound, I decided to make this a two-way speaker system, meaning that each channel uses two drivers, a woofer for the low frequencies and a tweeter for the treble. The drivers are by German company Fisaton. I chose them because they are inexpensive and sound pretty good for what they cost. I also had to make a crossover for each channel. That's a special circuit whose job is to split the input signal and send only the low frequencies to the woofer and only the highs to the tweeter. After I had a good idea of what electronics I had to fit into the speaker, I came up with a quick design sketch. I chose to put the amplifier board and the crossovers inside their own enclosures at the back. And these are the two enclosures for the speaker drivers. I should point out that if you want to get the best performance out of a speaker, you have to put it inside a box of specific volume. For this particular speaker, Fisaton recommends three different enclosure volumes, of which I chose the 5-liter bass reflex. And if all of this sounds confusing, I will leave a link to a video explaining speaker enclosure types in more detail. To give my speaker a fancier look, I covered all sides with natural walnut veneer. It's a fairly simple process. I just glued the veneer to the plywood using wood glue and clamped it using pieces of scrap particle board to distribute the pressure evenly. On the next day, I trimmed the excess veneer using my router to get a nice clean edge. Then I sanded the piece for a smoother finish. Once that was done, I covered the entire front side in masking tape to protect it during the next few steps. Now was the time to cut the openings for the woofers, tweeters, and the bass ports. I started by marking the center for each opening with a pencil. Then I drilled a 5mm hole through each. And this is my super improvised circle cutting jig. It rotates around this 5mm pin, which sits between the piece and the jig. On the top is the router, which cuts the circle with a straight bit. Notice that I'm actually cutting two concentric circles for the woofers and the tweeters. The smaller will go all the way through, and the bigger will be only a few millimeters deep, so that the speakers lay flush with the front side. This is the result, and it's looking great already. Of course, I had to make sure that the speakers fit the openings, which they did after tiny corrections. I could now start gluing the plywood pieces together. First, I glued one of the sides to the bottom piece, and that was a good opportunity to use my corner clamps. Next in line was the front piece. One of the mistakes I made here was that I did not clean the glue squeeze out well enough while it was still liquid. By the evening, I had most of the pieces glued together, including the one separating the two speaker enclosures, and a large middle piece to which the electronics would be later attached. At this point, it was time to make the crossovers I mentioned earlier. I simply used an online tool to calculate the component values for me, and again, if you're confused by all this, I will leave a link to a video explaining what crossovers do and how to calculate them. Once the crossovers were made, I drilled holes in the middle piece of the speaker. This is where I glued standoffs for the amplifier board and for the crossover circuits. Here is the amplifier in place, and here are the crossovers with separate wires for the woofers and the tweeters going through the wall of the speaker. I glued the speaker wires to the sides of the speaker so that they don't move around. Now that all the speaker wiring is complete, I could seal the box with the top piece. But there was still a lot of work to be done. Next, I covered the left, right, top and bottom sides of the speaker with the same walnut veneer that I used for the front. Again, I trimmed all the excess veneer with a router or with a sharp knife. I did not forget to cover the exposed plywood edges on the front. This made a huge visual difference. Notice that the strips are cut at a 45 degree angle at the ends to create a more sophisticated look. After that, I sanded all the sides and edges for a smooth finish. By the way, if you follow me on social media, you probably know that I got a 3-in-1 CNC 3D printer laser cutting machine recently. I used it to design a wooden plate for the power and volume buttons for the speaker. Then I used the laser engraving feature to print the labels. And it turned out looking really nice. I wanted the buttons to be located on the top side, right above the amplifier board, so I made this opening. It is exactly the size of the circuit board where the buttons would be placed. Then I glued the wooden plate using the board with the buttons as a guide, just to be sure that all lines up well. And since playing with the CNC was quite fun, I decided to spice up the back cover of the speaker. These are all openings for ventilation, which are needed since the amplifier gets warm during use. And this at the bottom is where the power supply will be connected. I decided to paint this inner lip black to add some contrast to the look of the speaker. What I'm making here is a small piece to which the board with the buttons will be glued. It will provide the necessary support. The board itself is standing on small standoffs. I added a drop of paint to each standoff and pressed the wooden piece against them. This marked the exact places where I needed to drill holes for the standoffs. The user manual for the Arylic board has a wiring diagram that lets you connect your own control buttons, and that's what I used here. Unfortunately, there's an error in the diagram, but thanks to the Arylic forums, I was able to make my circuit work. I attached it temporarily to the speaker, where it was going to go later, and it looked awesome. Next, it was time to apply finish to the speaker. I covered all sides with several coats of matte spray lacquer, which really brought the wood to life. On the next day, I added the jack for the power supply at the back, soldered it to the amplifier board, and connected all the wiring before closing the back. After that, I soldered the wires to the speakers, screwed the speakers in place, and glued the base reflex ports. Finally, I glued felt pads in the corners on the bottom side. I listened to the speaker for some time, and while the sound was okay, I was not entirely satisfied. That's why I decided to try the board's DSP feature. I purchased the software from Arylic's website and started playing with it. I tweaked the equalizer, activated a couple of effects, and the sound became a lot richer. So I saved the changes, and at last I could say that this project was complete. Here is how the speaker sounds now. overall, I think this speaker turned out pretty well, and I learned quite a lot along the way. As always, if you have questions or comments, you can leave them below. Thanks for watching, and subscribe to my channel to never miss any of my future videos.